of himself as someone who can distance himself from his father, but at the same time benefiting from whatever is the are the alleged legacies of the Marcos regime. The intrafamilial dispute that we saw leading up to the filing of the certificate of candidacy made it clear that Inday Sara is different from the father, but she's still a Duterte.
I definitely think that this information, for example, propaganda, really plays a role in why Marcos Jr. is gaining ground in among low-income voters, low-income communities. The way that they use, for example, social media, they usually rely on free data. That means that certain information, for example, certain images, wouldn't really be accessible to them. And, you know, that makes them really vulnerable to disinformation campaigns, the use of fake news.
Experts also think the unity message of Marcos Jr. resonated with voters, despite the absence of a clear platform to help the Philippine economy recover from the pandemic.
Unity, no fighting with others. They're just attacking me. They have nothing concrete to offer. He's actually not offering something also, except unity in a very general sense. No? But that to me resonates to people because people are also tired of politics.
Lavinia also believes the opposition already consolidated the anti-Marcos and anti-Duterte vote and badly needs to get their voters to switch sides.
You can see that see, VP Len is just pushing 20%, no?
Yes.
And seems to really struggle to go beyond that. That's the most you can get for anti-Marcos, anti-Duterte. If she wants a winning strategy, she has to convert votes that are not anti-Duterte, anti-Marcos, that are even pro-Duterte and pro-Marcos.
The Marcos-Duterte camps welcomed that survey result, but experts caution these numbers can change now that the formal campaign has begun.
Hindi mo pwedeng sabihin na may nanalo na kasi RG, sa mga nakaraang mga survey, nakita natin ang malaking pagbabago sa rangko, sa antas ng suporta sa mga kandidato. At ito'y nagaganap hindi sa panahon na ito, Enero, kundi bandang Marso, pag nagsimula na yung kampanya.
Vice President Lenny Robredo's spokesperson believes the survey doesn't capture the effects of Robredo's appearances in media interviews in presidential fora, which they described as game-changing. The VP running mate of Leody de Guzman points out the survey was taken before the KBP forum, where de Guzman made the mark in public consciousness. A party mate of presidential bet Isko Moreno also believes the survey is premature.
Napakaaga pa. Voters are still thinking on their own. I don't think they will be easily swayed by an endorsement of the leader of their congregation. Hindi naman natin sinasabi po na hindi tayo bukas sa pakikipag-usap. Wala po tayong pag-iitsapwera, pagpapasa-santabi sa isang grupo man.
Senator Manny Pacquiao is unfazed, claiming rising levels of support in Visayas and Mindanao. Senator Panfilo Lacson, for his part, tells his supporters to keep the faith even if the surveys don't reflect the support seen on the ground. He also says he will not give up for the country's sake. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
The camp of Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. denies he is dodging challenging forums even as he skips another major event for presidential candidates and instead chooses to participate in a debate on a network owned by one of his backers. Willard Cheng reports.
Four presidential candidates will not attend the debate organized by Sunshine Media Network International or SMNI, a media firm owned by Pastor Apollo Quiboloy of the religious group Kingdom of Jesus Christ. Partido Reforma presidential candidate Senator Ping Lacson invoked common sense in declining the invitation. Lacson tweets, Quiboloy, the network's chairman, has already openly endorsed his preferred presidential and vice presidential candidates. Quiboloy, who's wanted in the U.S. for sex trafficking of children, has expressed support for the Marcos-Duterte tandem. From the presidential bet, Senator Manny Pacquiao also declined the invitation, saying he cannot in good conscience participate in an activity organized by a man accused of molesting children. Pacquiao also cited his pending cyber libel case against Quiboloy in avoiding the debate.
I am compelled to decline the invitation of SMNI
which is owned by Apollo Kibuloy, who according to the U.S. government has molested and abused children. I cannot, in good conscience, be part of any activity organized by a man wanted for detestable crimes and who uses the name of the Lord in vain for religious scams.
Manila Mayor Isko Moreno Domagoso's campaign manager Lito Banayo says his candidate will not be able to attend due to a scheduled visit to his mother's hometown, Allen, Northern Samar, which he was originally scheduled to visit in December but was cancelled due to bad weather.
It's very unfortunate that Mayor Isko Moreno Domagoso won't be able to attend the SMNI debates because his schedule is until tomorrow at hanggang gabi po siya sa Samar provinces.
Vice President Lenny Robredo spokesperson, Attorney Barry Gutierrez, says that while Robredo is willing to attend debates and interviews, regardless of the organizer's personal history or affiliation, the Vice President already had a prior commitment to visit Panay and said that she will be present for all upcoming COMELEC-sponsored and accredited debates. Labor leader Leody de Guzman has confirmed he is attending the SMNI debate. De Guzman said it's his obligation as a candidate to inform voters of his platform, even if he is attending what can be considered a Marcos home court. Attorney Vic Rodriguez confirms Marcos will show up in the SMNI debate.
I think SMNI format have responded to our call for an increase in the bandwidth on real issues. Rather than negativity or political mudslinging, the strategy even before our numbers reach this high is not to engage in negativity, not to engage in negative campaigning.
But Marcos declined to attend the presidential debate being organized by CNN Philippines on February 27, citing a scheduling conflict. The Marcos camp cannot say yet if the candidate is attending COMELEC-sanctioned forums, but denied he is dodging debates.
Our schedules are pretty full until the middle of April. But again, if we can adjust to it and the format will be is meant, if the format is designed in such a way that it will be given the candidates chance to present the platform, the governance, and their proposed solution, we might take and agree on appearing on those proposed scheduled debates.
Election watchdog Legal Network for Truthful Elections or LENTE reminds candidates it is part of their obligation to present their platforms to voters. Attorney Caritos urges voters as well to scrutinize candidates by participating in the COMELEC's official e-rally Facebook page, a channel where national candidates and party-list groups have the opportunity to introduce themselves and present their platforms. Willard Cheng, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine presidential bets rally their supporters in various regions of the country. Joyce Balancho with Monday's campaign brief.
Ferdinand Bongbong!
There are no permanent friends or enemies in politics. This was evident as presidential candidate Ferdinand Marcos Jr. greeted former Senator Juan Ponce Enrile, who celebrated his birthday with him in Cagayan Valley. Enrile was his father's former defense minister, and he also played a key role in the EDSA People Power Revolution that ousted the late dictator.
Ang kanyang birthday ay tamang-tama at bagay na bagay sa kanya dahil ito ay araw ng mga puso na imbag ti panangkasangay, Manong Johnny Ponce Enrile.
It is our pleasure to have you here to show you the love of the Cagayanos for the unity team that will bring forth the progress of the Republic of the Philippines.
After Cagayan, Marcos flew to Quezon City to attend their proclamation rally in the Amoranto Sports Complex. His running mate, Mayor Sara Duterte, was not present due to a prior commitment. In another political rally over the weekend, Senator Panfilo Lacson warned against electing government officials who steal from public coffers.
Kaya dapat, pag-upo natin doon sa polling booth, isipin muna natin, ba't nanakawang kaya ako nito? Tapos medyo balikan natin, ano ba istorya nitong taong to? Kasi madali magsabi, pag nasa entablado, madali magsabi, galit ako sa magnanakaw.
Vice President Leni Robredo, for her part, visited the national headquarters of the Philippine National Police and made a commitment to PNP Chief General Junardo Carlos that her office will continue to support the PNP in the remaining months of her term as Vice President. She also attended an event organized by artists who support her.
Yung power ng inyong pagka-artists and creatives, ibinubuhos ninyo para ipakita yung pagkakaisa. Na kahit saan man tayo, iba-iba yung ating pinanggalingan, handa tayong iset aside yung pagkakaiba ng ating mga paniniwala para sa pagmamahal sa bayan.
Manila Mayor Isko Moreno visited Calbayog City. He said his mother hails from Northern Samar.
Total, nasa Samar tayo. Never pa, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, for the past 60 years, walang na-elect ditong national official. I mean, in the national level. Walang senador to. Walang vice president to. Wala pa kayong presidente. I think the last time was in 1950s. Kahit anong kulay ng partido nila sa lokal, baka naman pwede niyong pagkaisahan. Yung anak ng Waray.
Meanwhile, former boxer Senator Manny Pacquiao denies he is the person mentioned in a blind item regarding a presidential aspirant who is allegedly planning to back out from the race.
I am a fighter and walang atrasan ito. At hindi, wala sa bukabukulari ko yung aatras para sa bayan. Kung hindi nga ako matras para sa sarili ko lamang, ano pa kaya yung para sa bayan? Para maipaglaban ko ang sambay ng Pilipino.
Labor leader Leody de Guzman, on the other hand, sat down for an interview with Radyo Veritas where he expressed his approval to legalize divorce in the Philippines.
Tingin ko, Father, magwawakas yung palaging sigalot, palaging kalmutan, palaging sigawan sa loob ng tahanan. Kapag binigyan natin ng laya yung mga mag-asawa, talagang pagkatapos ng mahabang effort ng komunidad, ng mga institusyon natin na pagbatiin o pagkasunduin, ay hindi magkasundo dahil wala nang love.
Joyce Balanso, ABS-CBN News.
A retired Philippine bishop strongly opposes the endorsement by Catholic Charismatic leader Brother Mike Velarde of the presidential candidacy of Bongbong Marcos. Bishop Emeritus Teodoro Bacani says it was wrong for the El Shaddai leader to give his support to the Marcos-Duterte tandem. The bishop is the group's advisor. Bacani points out Velarde's endorsement was his personal choice and was made without consulting other El Shaddai leaders. Bacani insists El Shaddai has not endorsed any presidential and vice presidential bets for the 2022 polls.
It's downright wrong. Alam naman natin ang record nila, no? Hanggang ngayon ay hindi pa nag-apologize ang mga Marcos doon sa ginawang mga katiwalian noong nakaraan. Never again, Marcos. Except if he says, I am sorry for what my father did. And we will return whatever money has not yet been returned to the Philippine government and to the Philippines.
Bishop. Still to come, Metro Manila authorities remain cautious and extend the region's alert level 2.
The World Tonight returns after the break.
We're back on The World Tonight. The Philippine government heeds the call of Metro Manila mayors and retain alert level 2 in the capital region until the end of the month. Meanwhile, 7 other areas in the country are placed under a stricter alert level 3. The details from Rafael Busano.
The National Capital Region will remain under alert level 2 until the end of the month. Malacanang made the announcement just hours after the Metro Manila Council urged the Interagency Task Force to extend Alert Level 2 in the NCR. Based on February 12 data, 32% of the country's COVID-19 tally were recorded in the NCR. The region's positivity rate still at over 7%, a few points higher than the World Health Organization's benchmark of 5%. And from 17 local government units, only 5 are considered low risk based on growth rate and average daily attack rate.
Hindi po tayo totally dapat magbukas immediately na titingnan natin yung ating healthcare utilization natin, tapos yung ating pong vaccination para sa ating 5 to 11 years old.
Ang iniiwasan natin yung another stage sa atin.
Sila kasi ang nakakaalam doon sa baba. And tama po yung sinasabi ni Mayor na talagang dahan-dahan.
For infectious disease specialist Dr. Ronjean Solante, extending alert level 2 for another 2 weeks is an opportunity for the public to prepare in the event that the region eases to alert level 1 next month. Vaccination rates can also be boosted in the next 2 weeks.
We are going to have it by March 1. I think we are fully ready if we are going to have it by March 1. We have less of the apprehensions of the possibility of spikes because more people are vaccinated.
For MMDA officer in charge Romando Artes, maintaining alert level 2 is a good move, which coincides with the first few weeks of campaign activities for candidates in the May elections.
Observe namin na maraming malaking pagtitipon ang medyo may violation. That's why yan po rin siguro yung isa sa mga consideration, dahil mahirap naman po talaga na i-regulate po itong napakalaking pagtitipon na ito na posible po na maging super spreader event.
Aside from the National Capital Region, Alert Level 2 will also be imposed in different provinces in Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Meanwhile, Alert Level 3 from February 16 to 28 has been hoisted in 7 areas including Iloilo City, Iloilo Province, Guimaras, Zamboanga City, Davao de Oro, Davao Occidental, and South Cotabato. The health department recorded 2,730 new COVID cases Monday. The country also reported 164 deaths and 7,400 more recoveries. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Over 100,000 children in the Philippines are now vaccinated for COVID-19. Authorities urge more parents to have their kids get COVID jabs and be a step closer to a normal life. Wen Acos reports.
Over 100,000 children aged 5 to 11 years old have been vaccinated in the pilot implementation of the pediatric vaccination last week, a number way above the initial target, according to Vaccine Czar Secretary Galvez. On Valentine's Day, the pediatric vaccination rolled out in different parts of the country, headed by Health Secretary Francisco Duque in Parañaque. Being cooped up in homes, children are now one step closer to getting a life with a semblance of normalcy.
Hindi lingid sa atin na ang mga epekto nito sa kanilang tinatawag na psychological development at ang kanilang mental health. Kaya naman napakahalaga na makapiling nilang muli ang kanilang mga kaklase, ang mga kanilang mga kalaro at kaibigan.
There are 482 vaccination sites across regions all over the country and 82 in the National Capital Region open for pediatric vaccination.
Kompleto po yung ating doses for 5 to 11. Meron po tayong darating na 6 million po ngayong buwan. Ito po good for even to the month of March.
Vaccination sites are recommended to have an area for pediatric inoculation separate from the adults and adolescents because the pediatric vaccine is a different formula. Just as in the pilot rollout, vaccine sites for children in Iloilo City, Naga, and Davao City have been transformed into wonderlands to keep kids entertained and alleviate their fear of getting jabbed. In Cebu, over 200,000 children have already registered, despite an initial supply of only 26,000 doses. The Visayas Vaccination Operations Center assured residents that more doses will be made available for the province soon. In Laguna, some parents got their boosters while their children got their first doses.
Protocol po sa school na bakunahan yung mga bata. Ngayon, magpapabooster pa kami. Kami mag-asawa. Sabay na rin.
St. Scholastica Marikina inoculated 400 kids on Monday. The pediatric vaccination is expected to continue while vaccination sites remain open for the extended national vaccination days, which will now last until February 18. Wen Acos, ABS-CBN News.
We're taking a short break.
Stay tuned to The World Tonight.
We're back on The World Tonight. The Kremlin believes recent comments by Ukraine's envoy to the UK shows no change in the country's intent to join NATO. But it adds Russia's security concerns would be significantly addressed if Kyiv does renounce its plan to become a NATO member. Ukraine's envoy to Britain clarified his earlier remark that the former Soviet Republic would not reconsider its attempt to join the Western Security Alliance. Moscow has repeatedly demanded that NATO bar Kyiv from joining the group. It warns this could be a trigger for war. Russia has moved more than 100,000 troops and heavy weapons to within striking distance of Ukraine, but it denies planning an attack.
South Korea will start giving fourth COVID vaccine doses by the end of this month. High-risk groups will be the first to get the fourth dose. Officials say some 30 million more home self-test kits will be distributed nationwide this month. These steps being taken amid an Omicron surge that has pushed South Korea's daily infections to record highs.
The PSE index is spared from a regional slump following dovish comments from the Philippine Central Bank. Michelle Ong reports.
Asian markets skidded on Monday as warnings that Russia could invade Ukraine at any time pushed oil prices to new seven-year peaks. The MSCI Asia-Pac Index ex-Japan dropped 1.4%. Japan's Nikkei 225 off by 2.2%, while Chinese blue chips fell by 0.75%. First Metro Securities' Royce Aguilar says, while rising oil prices is a key risk for net importers like the Philippines, the market looks set to rise, supported by earnings.
This week, we expect some more love for the PSE, especially the sharp drop last week was not really related to something fundamental. The effect of the PSE rebalancing, it's always because of, you know, funds are really making room for the higher market cap names. Because that's how it works, right? Higher market cap names going in, lower market cap names going out. So they had to sell a bit of the other names.
For the day, the PSE index bucked the slide, jumping 1.25% or 91 points to close at 73.61, despite net foreign selling of over 2.4 billion pesos. In corporate stories, FirstGen announces its 97-megawatt Avion power plant is now commercially available on both natural gas and liquid fuel after recommissioning and testing activities on Unit 1 were completed. Meanwhile, Century Properties Group priced its up to 3 billion peso five-year fixed-rate bonds at 5.7524% per annum, citing strong capital market conditions, allowing it to price the issuance at the higher end of the indicative range. This is the first tranche of its 6 billion peso debt securities program. 1 billion pesos from the proceeds will be used for the company's horizontal affordable housing projects under First Park Homes, a joint venture with Mitsubishi Corp. The rest for partial debt refinancing and other general corporate purposes. The group plans to launch 4 new master planned communities on top of the 3 just launched in General Trias Cavite, Baliwag Bulacan, and Tayabas Quezon. The 3 seen generating 2.9 billion in revenues. In all, First Park Homes has launched 11 communities already. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Edmund Burke. When bad men combine, the good must associate, else they will fall one by one.
And that is The World Tonight, the 14th of February, 2022. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay.